So, hi everybody. I'm glad you made it through the 5 or 6 feet of snow that we have piled up here. Welcome to the third annual Lester Kissel Lecture. I'm Arthur Applebaum, Director of the Undergraduate Fellowships at the Edmund J. Safra Center for Ethics, and I have the most pleasant duty of introducing our speaker this evening, Arthur Ripstein. But first, a few words about our dear Lester Kissel. Lester died in 2000 at the age of 98. He had been the managing partner of Seward & Kissel, a major Wall Street law firm specializing in financial law, representing banks, investment funds, hedge funds, and things like that. In his early 60s, he started reading Hindu ethics and asked himself, is this all there is to life? This being a lawyer for big banks. He began going to India, even had a guru who taught him that reincarnation is real, and that with sufficient study and work, he might come back as a worthy soul. Kissel's long-standing interest in values in public and professional life led to his commitment to the Ethics Initiative at Harvard that was just starting up, beginning with early conversations and correspondence with two of our presidents, Derek Bach, and then later Neil Rudenstein. Lester's magnificent gift to what is now the Edmund J. Safra Center was mainly structured, as some of you know, as a charitable remainder trust, meaning that Harvard would receive most of the funds only after his death. Each year, Lester would go off to see his guru in India, and each year he would come back 10 years younger. He'd visit us in the Ethics Center, reminding us to pay attention not only to ethics, but to, as he would say, values. And then again, he'd trot off to India, and then again, come back another 10 years younger. You see the problem. Not the actuarial problem, but the moral problem. Obviously, to hope that perhaps Lester might stop trekking to India quite so often would be a very, very unseemly, ungrateful, indeed wicked thought. We could have entertained such a thought, but in the immortal words of Richard Nixon, that would be wrong. So we, of course, extinguished any untoward judgment-sensitive attitudes and wished for Lester the longest and healthiest of lives. Alas, we had already had what the philosopher Bernard Williams described as one thought too many. If you were at the Kissel Lecture last year, you've already heard my public apology to Lester in whatever form his worthy soul has now taken. The only consolation I can draw comes from reading and rereading and rereading Arthur Ripstein on Kant. Strict right and wrong in Kant's political philosophy does not concern itself with mere wish or even mere need. Lester's will was never subject to our domination. I first met Arthur when we were fellows together at Princeton's Center for Human Values 20 years ago. What a miraculous year that was for me. Among the other fellows were Christine Korsgaard, Avishai Margalit, Michael Thompson, Arthur Ripstein, and me, the other Arthur. Without getting too autobiographical, it was the year that, despite my misspent youth, I was convinced that I really, really wanted to be a political philosopher when I grew up. Arthur was then working on what eventually became Equality, Responsibility, and the Law, a book about who should bear responsibility for bad luck. In it, he offers a penetrating reinterpretation and revision of common law principles about liability for torts and punishment for crimes. His account is grounded in the liberal egalitarian ideas of reciprocity and reasonableness. Who knew Blackstone was a Rawlsian? In retrospect, he already had his sights set on what became his magisterial exposition of Kant's political philosophy because he kept muttering about making the possible actual. Do you remember that? Yes, you do. For a number of years, Arthur ran a reading group at the University of Toronto that painstakingly picked through Kant's doctrine of right. He did eventually make the possible actual. The fruits of that effort, Force and Freedom, offers us a close reading of Kant's political philosophy. A close reading, not a defense. But not surprisingly, the clear and charitable explication of a great thinker's work serves as its own defense. The book is rich with insight. I will only mention the two that have transformed the way I think. The first is the conception of freedom as independence from domination of the will of others, rather than simply having unconstrained options. The other is that Rawls gave in too quickly to Hart's suggestion that he should speak of liberties in the plural rather than liberty. Ripstein revives this view that we can see liberty as one consistent, reciprocal system that resolves without remainder. I see a number of my students from various courses here. Try not to let it swell your head, Arthur, but I assign either chapters from Force and Freedom or your illuminating essay, Beyond the Harm Principle, in every course that I teach, and the students seem to have come back this evening for more. Arthur has two more books in the works, Private Wrongs, on philosophical aspects of tort law, which I hope will contain Beyond the Harm Principle in some form or another, and a project on Kant and the laws of war, parts of which Arthur will try out on us this evening. Please join me in welcoming Arthur Ripstein, whose lecture is entitled Perpetual War or Perpetual Peace.
Thank you, Arthur, for that very generous introduction. You'd introduced me before and you gave a generous introduction then, but I hadn't actually seen the other type of introduction you can give until just now, and so I'm particularly grateful for the generosity of your introduction. What I want to talk to you about this evening is Kant's idea of perpetual peace, which is, in turn, his idea of the nature of war. Kant describes war as barbaric. He says that it's the way of savages, and he says that it is to be repudiated entirely. Seems like a pretty clear view about what war is, but it seems like the kind of view of war that leads to the conclusion that there's nothing more to be said. Yet, he says this immediately after having given an account of right in war that has three parts. He talks about the legitimate grounds of going to war, he talks about the legitimate grounds of fighting a war, and he talks about what happens after a war. And so there's kind of a puzzle here. And it's not merely a textual puzzle about Kant, because Kant's repudiation of war, his claim that it is barbaric, is something that's widely shared. And yet we all think that there are, nonetheless, no matter how awful things are in war, there ought to be some kind of principles governing it. And the question is, what are those principles? Now, I want to say something about the way in which Kant approaches this problem, but I want to frame it in relation to other familiar ways of approaching it. As a general matter, Kant subscribes to a way of thinking about normative principles by looking at the object for which the principle is sought. This is an idea that gets expression in John Rawls's claim that in order to determine the regulative principle of a thing, we must first investigate the nature of that thing. But this is an idea that's much older than that. It's an idea that goes back at least to Plato's Republic and gets forceful expression in Aristotle, gets forceful expression throughout the Middle Ages. And the idea is, if you know what the thing is, then you will find its regulative principle. Now, when Rawls uses this, he says we want to find the regulative principle for a democratic society, or for a society viewed as a system of social cooperation. Now, if you start with something that is obviously valuable and you seek its regulative principle and its constitutive principle, the strategy seems to make perfectly good sense. So too, on prominent readings of Kant's argument for the categorical imperative, you figure out what the principle is for a free will. Assuming, of course, that a free will is something that is a worthwhile thing. In the case of war, something that we regard as barbaric, or at least that Kant regards as barbaric, it seems much less likely that one is going to find a regulative principle in its constitutive principle. How could the regulative principle be contained in something barbaric, given that regulative principles ordinarily are thought to require a thing to perfect itself, to become more fully what it truly is? Well, it would seem that the regulative principle for barbarism would be more barbarism. That doesn't seem right. I mentioned Plato's Republic here. And it might be thought that with respect to something that is barbaric and to be repudiated entirely, you're not really going to find an ideal principle by looking at its constitutive principle. You might think that, as Parmenides suggests in the dialogue of that name, that there are some things — Parmenides' examples are mud, hair, and dirt — that have no regulative principle. They have no form. They just are what they are. But Kant wants to say, despite its barbarism, war is not to be grouped with mud, hair, and dirt, but is rather to be understood in terms of its own ideal regulative principle. So what could this principle be? Well, the claim that I will make is that the regulative principle of war is peace. That is, if you understand the nature of peace, you understand how war must be regulated. That will be my claim. Now, I'm going to situate this claim in relation to two traditional ways of thinking about the law and morality of war. Each of these ways is prominent in medieval and early modern political thought. One of them continues to be prominent in contemporary thought. The other had about 5 decades of disappearing from view, but it too seems to be coming back. So the first of these, the one that remains prominent in contemporary discussions, is what's called the just war tradition. It has its explicit beginnings in the writings of Augustine, and it also then develops in Thomas Aquinas, and then it receives, in a way, its most sophisticated development in the Salamanca scholastics, particularly Vittoria and Suarez. For the just war tradition, the nature of war is to do justice. For the leading thinkers in the early just war tradition, and this, I think, is also true of its contemporary followers, the way to think about war is to think about it not as something terrible, but in a way as something that can be good. That is, as developed in particular by Vittoria and Suarez, the idea is that war is essentially a unilateral act that is done to address a wrong. It is done to stop some evil in the world. And so for the thinkers of Salamanca, this means it is to stop. It can be defensive, or it can be punitive, or it can be corrective. It would be defensive if it's preventing a wrong. It is punitive if it is addressing a past wrong. And it is corrective if it is, or commutative, as they said, if it is reclaiming something wrongfully taken. But the idea is it's fundamentally unilateral. The other picture of war, which has its, is often said to have its beginnings in Roman law, though it turns out that it has its real beginnings in Dante and then in later medieval Italian thought. There's just a passage from the first chapter of Justinian's Digest and from the second last chapter, each about 100 words long, on which they depend. But the regular war tradition, as I will call it, regards war on the model of a legal proceeding. Its leading exponents are the Dutch jurist Hugo Grotius, and then it receives further development in the work of Samuel Pufendorf and Emir de Vattel. For the regular war — actually, I should say something about the phrase regular war. The idea of it being a regular war is, in fact, quite a familiar idea in one way. If you think about questions about the status of irregular combatants in a war, you realize that there's an idea of what a regular combatant must be implicit in this contrast. The regular war tradition sees war as a mode through which sovereigns resolve disputes. It sees it on the model of a legal proceeding, and indeed Grotius's magisterial work, The Laws of War and Peace, actually is organized on the model of a classical medieval legal treatise. Book one tells us what war is. Book two tells us about the potential causes of action through which one might go to war. And book three tells us about the nature of the procedure through which a dispute is resolved by war. And so, just as if you were studying contract law in the Middle Ages, you would learn both what a contract is, then you would learn the ways in which contracts are formed and the ways in which contracts can be breached, and then you would study the procedure through which breaches of contract are addressed. So, Grotius says, to understand war, you have to understand the idea of war as a formal legal proceeding. This idea is developed in Grotius in ways that overlap with the just war tradition. Grotius sometimes talks about the need for a just cause, and he acknowledges the possibility of both punitive wars and defensive wars. But his main concern is actually with neither of these, but instead with the regular war, or the formal war, as he sometimes calls it. That is, the war in which there is no question of who is in the right. The point of the procedure is to resolve the dispute. Neither sovereign needs to defer to the other. If neither needs to defer to the other, then they should try mediation. If mediation doesn't work, they should try arbitration. But of course, the problem with arbitration is that it may be that the arbitrator will make a recommendation and one side will choose to ignore it. Likewise, they might, Grotius suggests, have champions. We have our gladiators fight it out, kind of a duel for the sake of everyone. But there too, what if the wrong side wins? The thing about war that makes it the final procedure for Grotius is that it is the only self-executing procedure. There is no space between victory in the war and the resolution of the dispute. Now, both the just war tradition and the regular war tradition lead to a lot of wars. But, now, this is partly because they each think of war in a positive way, but I'm going to come in a moment to the deeper reason. But let me give an illustration. Vittoria and Suarez were interested in justifying the Spanish conquest of the Americas. Now, they were very critical of the Spanish conquest, but then they came up with their own justification of the general form. If the indigenous peoples of the Americas are resisting the settlement of underutilized land or the good works of missionaries, then they can be punished for that. And furthermore, if we know that they're going to do that, we can simply send our settlers and missionaries with armies. Why? Well, notice the model for the just war theorists of Salamanca is that war is a unilateral act, that is, that the country going to war is each of prosecutor, judge, and executioner of the law of nature. And so, the dispute is already resolved, we know who's right, and if we are right, we are going to go to war. We are entitled to go to war, we are entitled to use force in this way. Now, there are other examples too, but I mention that one because it does seem to generate a lot of war. And of course, it might be thought, this is an example that is perhaps unfair to the thinkers of the just war tradition, in that we now think that this was terrible, that it wasn't justified. But I want to suggest that there's a different problem. It isn't merely that we disagree with them about the merits of the case. There's something else wrong that I'll come to in a moment. But first, something more about the regular war tradition and the way in which they justify a lot of war. Grotius wrote his first work, De Jure Prada, as an explicit justification of Dutch colonial activity in Southeast Asia. But I think to understand the nature of the regular war tradition better, we shouldn't look at Grotius merely as an apologist for Dutch colonialism. We need to look at him in a broader context, and we need to look at the nature of his claim. He says that in a formal war, the two belligerents are resolving their dispute through this legal mechanism. And he says, why is this? Well, just as the just war tradition said, because justice must be done, therefore people are entitled to go to war. The regular war tradition says, because otherwise rights would be impossible. Why would they be impossible? Think of it this way. If you have a right, part of what it is to have a right is that it cannot be violated with impunity. That is why, if someone steals your coat, it continues to be your coat, even after they've stolen it. If it could become their coat by them stealing it, you wouldn't have a right to it, and in some sense, it wouldn't really be yours. This is just a formal feature of any kind of claim about a right. Now, what Grotius sees is that once you realize this feature of rights, you couldn't have a right unless there was a way of securing it. But now, what happens if a right is in dispute? Well, Grotius, writing in the 17th century, gives a 17th century answer. We all get together and we appoint a ruler, and the ruler will resolve the disputes for us. We all report to the ruler. That's the sense in which the ruler is our sovereign, and so the ruler can tell us, as between us, the resolution of a dispute and impose a resolution. But what happens if there's no ruler, that is, when it's a conflict, a dispute about rights between two rulers? Grotius gives examples like the river shifted its course, as a result of which things are on different sides of the border. What now? Well, of course we should settle it peacefully. But do we have to? And the answer is no. We're always entitled to stand on our rights. But Grotius says, if there is no way of resolving disputes about rights, they're meaningless, and so therefore there must be the ultimate mode of resolving disputes about rights, which is to say, there must be either a court, or if no court is available, or the court gives the wrong answer, you must be entitled to go to war. Now, this is going to give you a lot of war. And in Vattel, this leads to his justification of Frederick the Great's war to capture Silesia. Frederick the Great inherited Silesia, and there was a question about the nature of the inheritance. The inheritance was contested. And so, we all know about cases where there is a contested will. What do? You go to court. What do you do if you're Frederick the Great and there is no court? You go to war. Now, Vattel thought that the best way to do this was to have a very civilized, orderly war, and to have just a pitched battle through which you resolve the dispute by the two parties agreeing, we're going to have our soldiers kill each other for 45 minutes this afternoon, and whoever's left standing gets Silesia. My son is in seventh grade, and so he's studying Canadian history, and so he's learned about the Battle of the Plains of Abraham, which was a pitched battle, which the British won because they used two rows of soldiers. And so they had them fire, and then they ducked, and the other ones, and they won, the other side ran away. Now, that's war as a legal proceeding. So, what's wrong with these two pictures? Kant's claim is that the problem with both of them is that they fail to recognize the true problem of war. The true problem of war is not simply that people get killed, that is a terrible problem, but the thing that's fundamentally wrong with war, according to Kant, is that it resolves a dispute by force, that force rather than right decides. That is the sense in which he regards war as barbaric, because barbarism is, for Kant, a technical term. It is a situation in which there is force with neither freedom nor law. War is barbaric. What's the alternative? Well, the alternative is peace, but how is peace the alternative, and how can it be the alternative in a way that preserves what seems to be right about both the just war and the regular war tradition, namely that there must be some moral ideas here? Well, Kant's answer rests on two ideas. The first is an idea about the nature of the state. Kant will claim if you understand the public nature of the state, you understand part of how there can be a morality governing war. And second, the second thing you have to understand is that war is, and here the regular war tradition is onto something, is a way of resolving disputes apart from their merits, but that a public state, a system of public law, could only be entitled to do that in a certain way. And he'll claim, in a way that I'll explain in just a moment, that both the just war tradition and the regular war tradition go to the extremes they do because they don't understand the public nature of a state. So, what does it mean to say that the state has a public nature? Well, when I was invited to give this lecture, I was told, oh, we'd like you to come give a lecture at the Safra Center. You know, we have this theme about institutional corruption, but we don't want you to talk about that. And so the hands didn't go like this in the email. But I'm going to just say something related to institutional corruption because I think that is the best way to explain the public nature of a state. And I'm going to say it with an example of very, very small scale corruption. Also, this is a favorite example of mine that is going to expire very soon. Calling things glacial used to be one of my favorite metaphors. Now my students think it means disappearing quickly. So, here's my favorite example. Remember when you used to get things in the mail? And sometimes you would get something from someone in the University of California system. And there would be the little return address with the UC crest, and then there would be the list of all the UC campuses. And then underneath the list, it would say, penalty for private use, $500. The idea is that this, if you work in the UC system, you have this envelope, you're allowed to use it for official UC business. You are not allowed to use it for your own private purposes. Now, of course, there are going to be hard casuistical questions. Can you send someone a letter and say, P.S., glad to hear your kids are doing well? That's a casuistical question, but it's a question around the edges of a perfectly straightforward distinction. To use it for a public purpose is to use it, in this instance, for the purposes of the University of California, as determined by its governing bodies and all of their procedures. To use it for a private purpose is to use it for some private purpose of your own. Now let's scale this example up a little bit. For Kant, the idea of a public rightful condition is just the idea that the purpose of a state is to provide for rightful relations between its citizens. this entitles the state to do all kinds of things that no private person is entitled to do. For example, the state can, as acknowledged by the regular war tradition, impose binding resolution on disputes. The state can punish wrongdoing, something that we as private persons are not allowed to do. The state can take things from one person and give them to another so as to sustain the rightful condition, as when, for returning to my small-scale example, for example, tax funds are used to fund the University of California system. I guess that's also becoming outdated. So the structuring idea is that the state gets to do all of these things, but it gets to do them in the service of providing a rightful condition for its citizens. But there are lots of things, including lots of worthwhile things, that it does not get to do. It does not, for example, get to simply act on the tastes or preferences of a large number of its citizens. Indeed, even if everyone agreed that wouldn't it be nice if we did this, those are merely convergent private purposes. They're not a public purpose. To act for a public purpose is just to provide a rightful condition. Now, I should say, lest it sound like I have a very narrow conception, or Kant has a very narrow conception of a public purpose. I want to say, yes, it's a very narrow conception of the purpose of the state, but he has a very broad conception of that narrow purpose. That is, you need legal institutions to do it. Those legal institutions need to be representative, and so there are lots of things that the state will do in furtherance of its public purpose. Now, what does all of this have to do with war? Let me mention two things. The first is, if you think about relations between states, you will see, first of all, that although there is some analogy between relations between states and relations between individual human beings, the analogy is potentially misleading. Because the thing about individual human beings is that each of us has our own private purposes. Each of us is able to and entitled to set and pursue our own conception of the good. States aren't like that. I'm not making a psychological claim that somehow states don't have a collective mind. Maybe they do, maybe they don't. It's rather a normative claim. States don't have standing to have private purposes in the ways in which you and I have standing to have private purposes. They just have the public purpose of being a rightful condition for their citizens. Notice that one implication of this is that no state does another state any wrong by providing a rightful condition for its own citizens. But the other implication is that though the state can make many demands on its citizens, it cannot make unlimited demands, and it can't make any demands for merely private purposes. And so, although citizens can be called upon to help defend the state when it is in danger, in genuine danger, they can't be called upon to advance its private ambitions or the private ambitions of those who hold power. Let me contrast this idea with the view of the nature of the state that one finds in the just war tradition and in the regular war tradition. The regular war tradition regards the state as essentially private. Indeed, if you read particularly the classic thinkers of it, that is Grotius, Pufendorf, Vattel, but also their the most prominent 20th century defender, Carl Schmitt, the idea is there's a linear relation. You report to your superior, and there is a chain of superiors, And that means that your superior, that is, your ruler, can order you to do whatever serves the ruler's purpose. Because the nature of the ruler in this picture is reporting to no one higher. But it's a linear reporting relation. Everyone reports to whoever is above them in the hierarchy. And whoever is at the top reports to no one, but other than that is essentially a private person. I am the state, says the king. Now, on that model, unsurprisingly, the writers in the regular war tradition all supposed that the state's territory was its property. That is, it's to inherit, to pass on, to give away, to mortgage, and so on. Now, I know that I'm speaking in a country that purchased both Alaska and Louisiana, but I'll talk about how to look at war retrospectively later. There's something wrong with that, from Kant's point of view, precisely because territory is always not the state's property, but rather closer to its body. That is, it is the location where this rightful condition holds. So, the regular war tradition thinks of the state as essentially private. But of course, then you have the problem of private disputes, to which I drew attention. By contrast, the just war tradition sees the state as having essentially a universal role. It supposes that the reason rulers have power is that they are engaged in moral purposes that they happen to be well positioned to engage in. Now, I'm oversimplifying here. There is a split between Vittoria and Suarez. Suarez thinks that the state can only go to war to uphold, to punish someone who has wronged it, whereas Vittoria thinks that the state can go to war to punish any wrongdoer whatsoever. So Vittoria has a more universal jurisdiction. But the picture with which the just war tradition works is one on which the purpose of the state is to do good in the world, including doing justice in the world, including righting wrongs in the world. And so the state is entitled to do that wherever, and is entitled to, the thing that's distinctive about the state is simply the fact that the state has no superior, and so it does not need to consult anyone else before doing that. And so it is always entitled to act unilaterally. Suarez worries a bit about this. He says, well, what about the allegation that this would make the state judge in its own case? And his response is twofold. The first part is, well, you know, the king will have advisors. They'll be much better. The problem of being judge in your own case is usually just a problem of insufficient information. And the second part of his answer is, even if that weren't true, wrongs must be righted. Justice must be done. And since there's no one else to do it, we have to take it on. It is our mission. So you have this picture where, for the regular war tradition, the state is private and so has an unlimited private agenda as grounds for war. Just war tradition, it's universal, but it has necessarily an unlimited agenda for going to war. Kant wants to say, no, we have to realize that the state is essentially public. And once we realize that it is essentially public, we can see the sense in which war is a mode of dispute resolution, and we can see the sense in which war is necessarily limited, and we can see the sense in which war is for the sake of peace. So, Kant writes that if one wants to find right in the situation of war, one must assume something analogous to a contract between the belligerents that they will resolve their dispute in this way. Now, this sounds a little bit like the regular war tradition as I've just reported it. But as always, when Kant talks about what one must suppose, he's talking not in terms of empirical hypotheses, but the very possibility of a situation making moral sense. And what I want to suggest to you is that when we see how he frames this, we see why this is the right way of thinking about war. So to see how he frames it, though, let me immediately concede that there's something bizarre about this. There are, of course, cases, the Battle of the Austrian Succession being one of them, where the parties really did sit down and say, okay, well, let's just have our soldiers kill each other instead of having a chess match or something. No other way to resolve it. But ordinarily in war, if anything could be described as ordinary in war, at least if we look at the way in which people write about wars after the fact, ordinarily there is someone who is the aggressor and there is someone who is the defender. And the idea that, for example, when Germany invaded Poland, that Germany and Poland sat down and said, well, you know, we have this intractable dispute, how about we fight it out? No, nothing like that. So the question is, how are we to find right in war? Why do we have this, why should we accept this crazily artificial picture? Here's why. Kant's organizing thought is that if we're going to find right in war, we have to look at war in a way that lets us see it as an activity in which the parties could be entitled to engage, given their nature. If both belligerents in a war are public rightful conditions, something that they both are in a minimal sense, even if they're doing a terrible job of it, either internally or externally, then the only thing they could be entitled to do is using force to resolve a dispute. But they could only be entitled to use force to resolve a dispute subject to two further conditions. The first is that at the end of the war, the dispute will be resolved. Kant wrote a famous popular essay called Perpetual Peace. It was one of many famous essays called Perpetual Peace written in the last part of the 18th century, in which he begins with preliminary articles. The first preliminary article of Perpetual Peace is that any peace treaty must not contain a secret reservation allowing new grounds for war to break out. If war is a procedure, it must provide closure. That's what a procedure has to do. And so, once we see this first feature of war as a procedure, we see the sense in which one must suppose something analogous to a contract between the belligerents. That is because consider the case where one country A attacks country B. Country A is trying to resolve something through force. Country B did not agree to resolve it in this way, in any explicit way. That is, Kant is not saying, oh yes, war is this wonderful cooperative joint activity in which parties engage, kind of like baseball, only bloodier. I guess I should have said hockey, only bloodier. So, but instead, think about it this way. The two belligerents are fighting. The first one attacked the second, and the second one responded with force. That is, the second one accepted that the dispute will be resolved in this way. And they didn't, the first one may not have gone to war because of that. They may have gone thinking, this one's gonna be easy. May have thought, we're better than them. May have thought whatever they did. But what they did is create a dispute resolved by force. And the second country, in responding with force, joined a dispute to be decided by force. As I said, this is not to say that we have a cooperative activity or a joint activity, but the only way in which either side could be entitled to participate in this non-cooperative activity is if it can be thought of and is conducted in a way that holds out the possibility of a subsequent joint activity on its basis, namely peacemaking. That is, it must be, and this brings me to the second point on which Kant's view of the nature of war turns, it must be that war is conducted in a way, A, capable of resolving the dispute, and B, consistent with the survival of both belligerents. It is their dispute. That is the sense in which we must regard it as analogous to a contract. Each has resigned itself to doing it, to fighting in this way, to resolving the dispute in this way. But that resignation can only be rightful provided that the procedure will in fact resolve the dispute. Now, once we see this, I want to suggest, we then see why it is that the parties to a war are always fighting with the possibility of peace in mind, and that not, this is not a factual claim, but they must be taken to. And we'll see that that is going to constrain each of the ways in which, the grounds on which war can be fought, the ways in which war can be fought, and what happens after a war. That is, we can now see why it is that the constitutive principle of war is peace. War is barbaric because it is the condition in which a dispute is resolved independently of its merits. Peace, by contrast, is civilized. But the thing that's civilized about peace is, of course, simply the fact that it's not war. That is, disputes are not resolved by force. They are resolved instead on their merits. That's what it is for us to have a functioning legal system on a domestic basis. And that's what it is to have international institutions or treaties that provide for peaceful resolution of disputes, that provide fora through which disputes can be resolved. The thing about peace is that it makes it possible to resolve a dispute on its merits. But that means if a dispute can be resolved on its merits rather than through force only under a condition of peace, then we have in the concept of peace the organizing principle for the morality of war. That is, if a dispute can only be resolved on the merits in a condition of peace, then it can't be that either the just war or the regular war tradition is correct. The just war tradition supposes that the dispute is already resolved on its merits. That's why it supposes that the country, typically a powerful country, is entitled to act as prosecutor, judge, and executioner of the law. But Kant wants to say it's only in a condition of peace that the dispute can be resolved on its merits. But that means we can't start with the assumption that we know the merits. Not because the merits are unknowable. There are some totally uncontroversial cases. It's rather we can't start with that because then peace would need to precede itself and so would finally be impossible. The only way in which peace is possible is if we suppose that the past has been settled by war. The only way we can have peace is if we regard the results of war as determinative. If the war ends and the dispute continues, then the war hasn't ended. The only way we can have peace, perpetual peace, that is, self-sustaining peace, is if the past is wholly settled. What is war? War is the way in which the past was settled. And if we find ourselves in a war, the only way that we can be entitled to fight it is in a way that regards it as providing a settlement consistent with the continued existence and peaceful coexistence of the belligerents. Once we see this, I want to suggest we then see something that looks very much like the requirements of the legal requirements of the law of war coming out of the Kellogg-Briand Pact of 1928. First, grounds of going to war. Only grounds of going to war aren't really grounds of going to war. Because the only grounds you can have for waging war are going to be defensive, that is, disturbance of the peace. You can only go to war to stop someone from attacking you or from attacking someone else and thus disturbing the peace. There can't be a punitive war, and there can't be a war of acquisition. There can't be a punitive war because a punitive war would suppose that you had standing to resolve the dispute on its merits. There can't be a war of acquisition because there is nothing you could acquire rightfully except on its merits. Of course, there's a temporal asymmetry here, that is, things were acquired through war in the past. But we can't reopen that, because if we reopen that, then peace would need to precede itself and so be impossible. So the grounds of war, such as they are purely defensive, and plus there can be grounds of war with international authorization. But that is to say, they're purely defensive. That's just another layer of the same thing. What about the fighting of a war? There's been a large literature in recent years trying to revive the just war tradition that's argued that one of the fundamental features of the modern law of war is morally mistaken. That is the feature that focuses on what is sometimes called the moral equality of combatants, according to which combatants on both sides of the war are entitled to kill each other, but nobody else. And that, this is the part to which many people have taken exception, doesn't matter who's in the right. This rule applies no matter what. Now, it's easy to point out that this does not really fit very well to the ways in which we think about the use of force in other contexts. If I attack you, and you defend yourself, I'm not allowed to defend myself against your defensive force. And it might be asked, why would states be different? Well, I want to suggest Kant's way of setting up the problem gives us a way to understand why states would be different. If war is a procedure through which a dispute is resolved independently of its merits, then the merits are no part of the procedure for resolving the dispute. Think about it this way. You and I have a dispute about something, we can't agree, and so we say, okay, you know what? We'll play chess to decide. And then I say, and you know what else? Since I'm right in the dispute, you have to play without a queen. I can't do that. Why can't I do that? It is in the structure of our form of interaction that I can't do that. We are symmetrically situated with respect to that procedure. Now, why think of it as a procedure? Why don't we just think of it as a bunch of people on a field killing each other? The answer is the only way either side is entitled to engage in this at all is under the idea of a procedure. Now, I don't mean to suggest that war is like a chess match, though someone might suggest that a chess match is like war, or is supposed to be like war. The big difference between them, of course, is that war is self-executing. As we saw in talking about the regular war tradition, there is no conceptual space between the result of the procedure and the resolution of the dispute. Nonetheless, the formal feature of the parties being symmetrically situated remains. Finally, I want to say something about right after war. If there can be no punitive war, then there can be no requirement of reparations after the war. Neither side is entitled to say that because we won the war, we were right. But that means neither side is entitled to say, I mean, everyone's entitled to say whatever they want, but is entitled to say as a matter of the legal relation between the states, because we were right all along, we won the war. Because having accepted to resolve their dispute in this way, the parties, however disappointing this is for them and however horrible it is for all involved, have given up on the merits. And so they must not take victory to be a sign of the merits. After a war, the victorious party cannot dismember the vanquished, cannot create a colony, cannot do any of the things that historically states have done because of the way in which we think of war as this form of dispute resolution with a narrow purpose that must resolve this dispute so that peace is possible in the future. So I've suggested to you that for Kant, the way to think about war is to think of it as a prelude to peace, as a procedure for establishing the terms of peace. This doesn't make war a good thing. It never confers an entitlement to go to war, but it tells us what is and isn't permissible in the course of war. Notice that although the grounds of war, the conduct of a war, and what happens after a war are conceptually connected to each other, they're also distinct. That is, a nation fighting a defensive war can fight it using unacceptable means. A nation that fights a defensive war with acceptable means can then behave inappropriately after the war, and so on for all of the other combinations. These are all connected but separate moral standards. You must not go to war, but if you go to war, you must not fight it except in this way. And if you go to war for good or ill and fight it however you do, you must not claim victory and thus that you were in the right, and you must not colonize those who you defeated. So I want to suggest that by thinking about these ideas, we're able to see the way in which peace is the constitutive principle of war. And so we're able to see that war, although it is barbaric and to be repudiated entirely, is nonetheless not to be grouped with mud, hair, and dirt as things that are simply are what they are. And so we see that even in the most barbaric of circumstances, morality always has something to say, even if neither side will listen. Thank you.
Arthur, we have time for questions. You can't all hear me. That's because I didn't press this button. But if I press this button, then you can. I'll call on you.
Or if you talk to my tie.
Or if I talk, that's right. But if you're a little far from a tie, so please press the button before you ask your question. And Francis Kam has the first question.
Button. Now you can hear me. Okay. So Arthur, I don't understand some things. First of all, this sounds like a very unappealing theory. to me, at least. But when Germany invades Poland, suppose, to take your example, on this view, if Poland responds with force, it has now accepted the idea that the dispute between them will be settled in this way. And it doesn't seem to me true that when a country is trying to defend itself against being, you know, run over, that there is any implicit agreement at all that it's responding with force is an agreement that this is what's going to settle the dispute. It's merely trying to, you know, push back something that is harming it, right? If it had agreed to this, first of all, I mean, other countries, I know the analogy with people is inappropriate, I recognize that as much, but other countries couldn't say, look, there's been the so-called the rape of Belgium, right? Belgium lost the war, or Poland lost the war, okay? We have to go in and do something about Germany. No, you'd have to wait until Germany did something to you in order to respond, it seems. Because they agreed by responding to the force of Germany that the dispute between them would be settled by this means, and they lost. It doesn't seem to me that that's the correct way of viewing things at all. The other thing is that it doesn't seem to me that you have to accept the ending of the force. Suppose one side wins, right? Suppose Poland had won. You know, it might be the case that the way Poland sees it, given, suppose it's committed to the idea that disputes should be settled on merits if they can be. Another reason for them not to think that we've committed to this resolving mechanism of force is to say, the way we see force is it's a way to stop this aggressor, hold them in check, and now establish a court in the condition where the court will decide the dispute between us. We were willing to do that before. Germany was not. We have used force in order to make it the case that we can now, in a sense, not have resolved the dispute between us, but begin the resolution by the appropriate means. That could be another reason why it uses force. My minor concern, those are my major, really major concerns, and I know that you have a way of explaining this to me, I think, as you explained many things in the past. But the other thing, may I just say one thing? You said that war was barbaric because it settles disputes independent of the merits. But that would mean that tossing a coin is also barbaric, and that doesn't seem to be true. That's just a matter of definition. Sorry.
Okay, so... Okay, so... Okay, well, I hope to respond. So let me answer your questions in a different order than you asked them, because I think actually your point about tossing the coin is the key to the answer to the other two. So you might say, well, why not describe that as barbaric? And the answer is that we can, and the reason I say this goes to your other questions is this gives you a sense of the meaning of agreement and acceptance and so on. If you and I agree that we will just flip a coin to resolve some question before us, it's within each of our power to, we're supposing, to resolve that question either way. And so we are entitled to simply have an arbitrary decision. I take it that if the, instead of the War of the Austrian Succession, there were the flipping of a coin with respect to the rightful condition in which the inhabitants of Austria previously were, there would be something wrong with that. And so there is something wrong with fundamental questions of who is a member of which rightful condition, and whether there are rightful condition, this, there is this rightful condition at all, should depend on something other than the merits. And so war is the limiting case of that. That's why I mentioned Grotius goes through this succession of mediation, arbitration, champions, and so on. But once you get beyond mediation and arbitration, you've given up on the merits, and you're in barbarism, even if nobody gets hurt.
That's a clarification of the definitional.
Okay, but now, so I didn't say that Poland has consented. I said instead that they have accepted that this dispute will be resolved through force. Now, you have a two-part question. In what sense have they accepted that? And the answer is, first of all, look what they're doing. They are using force. The question of where the border is going to be or whether Poland will continue to exist will depend on force. That is the principle on which they are acting. It's not a principle they endorse necessarily. But now, the other point is that their entitlement to use force in this case, I want to say, you can describe it, oh, well, they're entitled to do it because they are defending themselves against aggression. The question is, and why is a state entitled to do that? The answer is, they are entitled to, in what way is a state entitled to do that? And the answer is, with an eye to a possible future peace. Now, let me come to the second part of your question. Well, what if instead we're going to just force them to go to court? It's like someone is attacking me, and instead of fighting back, I just grab him and drag him to the police station, and so on. There, we have a mechanism in place that is binding on both of us, namely taking the person to court. Here we're talking about a situation in which there is no mechanism in place. There is no court in place. And so when we resolve this, when we have this dispute and then set up a court after the fact, what we are doing is resolving the dispute, that is, we are using force to bring this person before a court.
Wait a minute, there was a League of Nations. Suppose there was an international criminal court before and Germany violated the rules, okay? I use the force to get Germany to go to the court. I'm not establishing court afterwards.
Okay, no, so now there wasn't a court. Okay. If you suppose that, then you're accepting the Kantian story, and so I'm perfectly happy with it. But let me...
Kantian story about why I'm accepting the idea that force is going to resolve.
No, that the Kantian story is we need to set up institutions that will resolve things on their merits. And so, of course, you are entitled to force people before those institutions if those institutions are set up. However, if one side says, I'm not going to the institution, I don't care what it does, I'm going to act with impunity because I'm stronger, I don't need a UN mandate, and the other side says, you need a UN mandate, you have a dispute that will be resolved through force. Now, the other thing to say is that you asked about what about the rights of third parties. So in the longer version of this, I have a discussion of that. Let me give you a capsule summary of it. The capsule summary is that a nation that acts in a way inconsistent with the peace and so is takes it upon itself to claim the territory of other countries through the use of force is a threat to everyone. And so other countries are entitled to intervene on that ground. But again, when they so intervene, they're intervening with force and they are creating a situation in which they're participating in a process through which the dispute will be resolved by force, not on the merits. And so it is, once again, the question is, in all of these situations, they're resorting to force. Nobody thinks, at least since the 15th century, that at when, I guess it was the 10th century when the ordeals were abolished, that force follow that force guarantees right. Nobody thinks that. In using force, you think you are in the right, and we can pick examples where we're all going to agree you're in the right, but nobody can think that force guarantees right. And so when you use the force to resolve a dispute, you are resolving it in a way that does not attend to its merits. And if you are doing that, then all of the questions come up. How can you be entitled to do that? And there the answer is to be given in terms of the possibility of a future peace, which generates the constraints on the ways in which you can do that.
So I'm trying to understand what's wrong with the
Regular war. Thank you. with the regular war theory. Towards the end of your lecture, you said this is what the problems are with the just war theory, and then I was kind of waiting for the parallel bit about the regular, and that never really came. So what I gathered from what you said on the way towards that, towards the conclusion, was you depicted the regular war tradition in a somewhat negative light because you gave us an understanding of the state that seemed to be rather unattractive. It's just a private business, and that was seemed to be the main signal that we're not, it's like a company almost, and we're not supposed to like that. But so here's a response to that on behalf of one of the protagonists that you mentioned there, namely Carl Schmitt, who I don't think is committed to this. Now, if you remember the famous first line of the concept of the political is, the concept of the state presupposes the notion of the political, which means, and that becomes clear in the course of the piece, that he develops an understanding of what the political is that doesn't depend on any particular understanding of what the state is. Right? So we're getting an understanding of what the political is. So the political is that comes so what makes us political is that we are organizing us into groups that are concerned about something to such an extent that they see their whole existential point connected to that, and who will inevitably reserve the option of going to war about that, and that's the only condition for war that Schmitz accepts. No moral ideals or religious ideals, anything, but if you see your existence threatened, then you can go to war, and that you are part of a group that sees its existence threatened as part of that description, that makes you a participant in a political context. Right? So now this is basically an anthropological theory of who we are as human beings. We get organized in such ways, right? And we get organized in these different groups that will go to war on occasion with each other for things that we really care about and consider existential. So this is the general theory, and that is quite consistent with whatever you want to say about the state. It can be, you know, private matter, a public matter. So it can't be what's wrong about the regular war can't be that they're committed to an implausible understanding of a state, because that's consistent to go with any understanding of a state. And then they would go in the offensive against you and say, look, What you want to get out of this, a dispute resolution and compatible with the continued existence of these two, this approach can handle much better, because the whole problem is, once you think of us as political beings, as in dividing in these groups that are committed to different existential purposes, is precisely that they're not agreeing on what the merits would be, what would count as a resolution and all that, right? So there's no, this vocabulary wouldn't apply. And so the best way, given all that, to reach as much peace as we could possibly hope for as human beings, if to organize a world where going to war is a means of politics, right? So because if you do it this way, then it's also possible to stay neutral, it's possible to make peace later. War in a way is less intense, it's less personal, it's less deep, because it's not just war tradition, it doesn't presuppose a framework for settling things, that's just what we do for a while, and then we go back to peace. That's the best hope for peace in the world, and they do have a lot of evidence, because the period when this paradigm was actually active between the middle of the 17th century and the First War was one of the most peaceful periods in human history.
So,
where are they wrong?
Okay, well, so everywhere. So, as I was listening to you, I was thinking, okay, is he going to actually say the sentence from Schmidt that is going to provide my answer, or is he going to leave it to me? And you left it to me. So, Schmidt wrote this. Schmidt heard a talk about the Kellogg-Briand Pact and went off and wrote the concept of the political, because he thought the making war illegal was just the most disastrous thing imaginable. After the war, I'll just leave out during the war, he wrote a book called The Nomos of the Earth, which is kind of a history of the concept of war, in which he talks about and defends the regular war tradition, and he laments that Kant tried to ruin it all. The organizing idea in the concept of the political is the distinction between friend and enemy. However, he says that this is, though he doesn't put it in quite this Kantian vocabulary, this isn't an empirical distinction. Instead, it's an institutional distinction, because it requires the concept of a sovereign, and the sovereign is, in Schmidt's words, he who decides the exception. The sovereign is the one who decides whether this is a threat. The sovereign is the one who decides what is the nature of our polity. Now, the sovereign can be an individual, or it can be a collective. Schmidt has a preference for individuals. In his discussion of politics in one of his other works, he talks at length about Lincoln suspending the Constitution during the Civil War. He said, this is the great moment. This is the moment of sovereignty. Nothing else matters. The Constitution is just there to provide an occasion for its own suspension. And which there's something, I mean, Schmidt's undergoing a revival, because there's something very powerful about that idea. And there's something, of course, very, very anti-Kantian about that idea. But now, in The Nomos of the Earth, he only talks about the exception once, that is, in his discussion of Kant. And he says Kant doesn't understand the role of he who makes the exception. And I want to say, the idea that there is someone who gets to make the exception, whether that person is an individual or an artificial person, an assembly of some form, doesn't matter. It is private in that way. If law can be suspended, if the purpose for which this political association exists can be take on any content whatsoever, as decided by the person who chooses the exception, that makes it fundamentally private. And so they can go to war over anything. And so the continued existence of the political society is something that can be put on the table. And so I want to suggest that when Vattel in one passage refers to the two sovereigns deciding to submit their dispute to a game of chance by sending their armies into pitched battle, and when Schmidt says the sovereign is he who decides the exception, they're saying the same thing. And they're saying the same thing because they regard it as fundamentally private. And so that's why it can take any content whatsoever, whereas the Kantian, the opposite extreme, can in a way take no content, can only have form.
That's a very peculiar notion of the private then, right? Because the reasoning behind this idea, sovereign is he who calls the exception, is that there are certain inherent limitations in what rules can do. You can write down all the rules you like, but there will always be scenarios that you haven't thought about. And then what, right? So somebody needs to do something then, and that's the sovereign. If that's what private means, that's not a very striking argument against the overall picture.
Okay. The rules, so first of all, we can have an offline dispute about how to read Schmidt and whether it's merely the point about the limitations of what can be codified. I think turning the Schmidtian sovereign into an Aristotelian court of equity is a little bit too charitable an interpretation. But more than that, it seems to me that the Schmidtian picture on which you can have your political society organized about around whatever substantive end it happens to be organized around is a fundamentally private conception of the state. And then the way in which Schmidt is complicated, he's often described as a political existentialist because he talks about the sovereign having the moment of choice. But the subject matter of the choice is actually what it is that we're about. And what it is that we're about is can take on any private content at all. And so in that sense, it is private. Even though you can imagine it taking on a particular content that's going to look very public, as in Schmidt's remarks about Lincoln. He picks Lincoln because he wants, in some sense, to privatize Lincoln rather than to understand Lincoln as defending a condition of public right.
I have a question up there, and then Dick Fallon has the last question.
I'm John Markham, I'm a graduate student in government department.
Can you push the button?
Can you press your little UN button? League of Nations button, sorry.
That good? Do I need to keep pressing it? Okay, there we go. I wanted to just pose some of the problems of the just war tradition back to you and see what you thought about them. And with respect not to the beginning of war or the origins of war, but rather to its end. And I was thinking back, so your basic argument seems to be that war rightly ends through an agreement between the parties to the war that is premised on peace. But there are some cases, I think, that in which we really, really, really don't think that that could rightly be the case. Let me give you two. In World War II, for example, paradigmatic case of the just war in American history, the American generals as well as the American political leaders throughout the course of the war came to think that the dispute could not possibly end with the German leadership as it was constituted, especially under Hitler, still in place or even alive, or even in the country at all. And so there could be no peace between the parties that were fighting the war or that had started the war to which the German leadership was still a party. That is that the German state had to be destroyed and reconstructed in order for peace to possibly be negotiated. So the end of that war was not thought by the Americans to be peace. It was rather a certain kind of peace in which that could only be negotiated with the German parties who had started the war completely out of the picture. In the second case, which is the American Civil War, a similar thing was at play. Lincoln came to think over the course of that war that it was not really about states' rights or kind of constitutional dispute about the possibility of secession. It was rather a war premised on slavery, and that the war could only be ended when slavery was abolished. And in fact, the war ought to be prolonged while it was being fought so that slavery could be abolished through national action, and that the foundation of the South, not just of its political leadership, but basically of its society, was, as George Stevens had put it earlier, that its cornerstone was slavery. Slavery needed to be done away with, Lincoln thought. And there was no condition on that in order for peace to be negotiated. And if the parties who had started the war in the South didn't agree with that, that is, didn't agree that slavery could be done away with, then the negotiation to end the war had to be done with other parties. So in short, I'll just wrap it up, is that sometimes we think, I think everybody in this room would think, that the constitutive principle of war is not peace, it's justice. And how could you think anything else, especially in those two great cases?
So, I hesitate to say anything about the American Civil War as a foreigner, or I guess carpetbagger on it. So, but let me say something about World War II, and then I'll make a brief remark about the Civil War. So, the claim that war needs to be fought with the possibility of a future peace does not mean that it needs to be fought in a way that recognizes the ongoing right to rule of those who happen to be ruling one of the belligerents. And so it is a condition of the legitimate end of World War II that, well, a condition that was not really properly realized because of the division of Germany, but that Germany is entitled to continue being a country. It cannot be removed from the earth, in Kant's phrase, or wiped off the map, in a more contemporary idiom. You can't do that to a country, even if it has done something wrong. And so the grounds of fighting that war were the restraining of aggression. Now, there are lots of complicating factors with Germany, because Germany was arguably a condition of what Kant would call barbarism in its internal constitution. It did not merely have a warlike external constitution, but it actually had a barbaric internal constitution. And so Kant is ordinarily deeply opposed to any claims to a right to revolution, but in a situation of barbarism, there is no real revolution. It's simply a matter of creating a rightful condition. That said, returning to my earlier remark, there's a requirement of legal continuity, and so if indeed the National Socialist period in Germany was a condition of barbarism, then Weimar Germany was still there in some sense and still entitled to be a nation. And indeed, this was the supposition of the post-war German courts that treated all of the edicts of, in particular, the Nazi race laws as simply void ab initio on the grounds that there was no authorization to create them. And so I'm not saying justice doesn't matter. I'm saying the way in which you fight a war is governed by the fact that it is a war. Now, with the American Civil War, things are complicated. Some might say that the antebellum South was a condition of barbarism. It's a morally tempting and conceptually perplexing picture because it was part of the same country as the non-barbaric North, and so there's a question of whether we can, whether we know how to think that. And there's a further question about what we do in the case of a civil war. When you have a civil war, the premise is not that both belligerents will survive. It is rather that the rebellion will be put down. I don't know enough American legal history to know how prominent the view is that this wasn't a war at all. I know there were legal debates about whether the South were entitled to the protections of military law, given that they were not considered an independent state, and there was all kinds of complexity about that that probably I know less about than anyone else in this room. And so I'm not going near that, but I'm merely pointing out that, again, whatever we say exactly about that case, that's not a case where it's organized in terms of the possibility of a future peace where both belligerents survive. You don't have an aggressor and a defender either. You have something different. And because of that, I am certain that many of the same things apply. That is, it is only through thinking of war under the idea of a possible future peace that we can understand why it is that something like the equal status of combatants on both sides would obtain, why it is that rules about prisoners of war would be appropriate, why it is that rules of sepulture would apply in this conflict. They don't apply in gang wars. What's different about this? And so I want to suggest that even though the final closure is going to be different, nonetheless, that you're going to get much of the same conceptual structure.
So the rules say we're out of time, but Dick, if your question can be brief and the answer brief, I'm not Schmidt, but I'll make an exception.
No, I think we're past.
Okay. Arthur, thank you so much.